All right, people. So here is the reproductive system. So this is like the light version. So just kind of highlight some important parts, and you can kind of see the overview here of what stuff we'll talk about. If we want to get more in depth with this, and if you want to hit the other body systems, right? Since we haven't talked about any of the other body systems like digestive and respiratory and cardiovascular and all those other ones, feel free to take my anatomy class. But I thought for the end of the year we'd try and fit in at least reproduction because that's a pretty important part. So sexual reproduction rights, we're going to talk about male and female, and I just want to kind of heads up and say when I'm using these terms, I'm talking about sex. I'm not talking about gender, but we'll kind of get into those terms a little bit as we move on. But the first thing about the reproductive system is you'll learn, and like if you ever take my anatomy class, that it's none of these body systems are really like isolated from each other, right? They're usually combined and work in tandem with everything in the body. You can't just like pull one thing out without tugging on the strings of all these other body parts. So as far as the reproductive system, it's part of the endocrine system. An endocrine system is all these glands and organs that make hormones. So as you can see, there's a whole bunch of them. There's probably a lot of these things you may have heard of, but you're not quite sure what they do. And for the reproductive system, we're going to focus on the testes and the ovaries because they're going to what secrete the sex hormones, so it's testosterone and estrogen. But they'd be grouped with all the different hormones. So here's your adrenaline right here. The adrenal glands sit on top of your kidney, so that's where your adrenaline or epinephrine comes from. Insulin from the pancreas for diabetes. Thyroxine affects your metabolism, so if you have like a swollen thyroxine gland, you might have problems. Or like an overactive or an underactive metabolism. And there's a whole lot other ones as well. But again, just a hormone, it's a chemical messenger that moves through the body. So instead of like your nerves that send signals with kind of like electricity, basically, and it's really fast, your hormones are kind of like your slow messengers. But the change can be pretty like pronounced, so it can have a pretty big effect on your body depending on if the hormones getting there or not enough hormones are getting there. So like I said, testosterone and estrogen, everybody has both of them, whether you're male or female. Like you have both, just kind of in different levels. And estrogen is actually generated from testosterone. So if you look at them, if you look at a picture of them, right, this is the actual chemical structure of them. They look pretty darn similar, right? So you can kind of see how estrogen might get formed from testosterone. And maybe, we're going to start blurring the lines between, are our sexes really that different? So I'm going to show you some stuff. We kind of think of things, very like these, like yes and no, black and white, like terms where, it's clearly one thing or the other, where the world's not really like that, right? So the world's a very complex place. And because of that, all of our characteristics in life are very complex. So you don't have to know all this stuff, but you can kind of see they all start out, hormones start out as a type of fat. So a lipid, if you remember lipids, so cholesterol. And then there's getting into testosterone, and estradiol is a type of estrogen. But that's just to show you it's really complicated, right? Okay, so if we're looking at this picture right here, this is kind of us, the fetus in the womb, right? And so this is around 4 weeks. About 7 or 8 is when you actually start to differentiate and actually start to go and like kind of quote unquote normal development, develop male genitalia, so the penis, or develop the vagina, so female genitalia. But what can happen is, before at this kind of, early stage, we would kind of say, all right, your kind of null sex is kind of female. It's kind of what we would really say undifferentiated. And then different cues would tell you to kind of which path to follow, right? So you might have certain cues or sex hormones that tell you, all right, you're going to start developing these tissues into, all right, here we'll develop in the penis, or you might follow this path where it will develop into the vagina. But notice there are homologous structures here. So the glands, the tip of the penis here is homologous to the clitoris. And so both are very much intertwined with pleasure, right? That sensation, that bundle of neurons, the more sensitive areas. So they are homologous to each other, if you guys remember that term from evolution, right? But what can happen, since the world isn't always, just one way or the other, because it's an influence of many genes and many hormone levels going on, and it's not just like one, you can get what we would call atypical genitalia, where you might not be expressed one or the other, either extreme. You might fall on this Prader scale right here. Now, I'm showing you this to kind of show you, this isn't super common, but neither is it like super rare. So, to kind of develop, depending on different genes and different hormones being expressed, it can occur. And you can get what we would call differences in sexual development. And so, I know I have the word disorder up here. We've kind of moved away from the word disorder. This is just one. And so, this would be a person that has both ovary and testicular tissue. So, they have both, quote unquote, gonadal tissue. So, gonads are the testes or the ovaries, what produce the gametes, right? Your sex cells. And so, there are many different causes. A lot of them are unknown of why you could fall in between. In this case, one possible one would be a certain gene on the Y chromosome isn't being expressed, and that is the one that would cause a lot of the secondary sexual characteristics. So a person could be XY, but if this gene is busted, they're going to, I shouldn't say busted, I guess. If it's not working, then they're going to develop as just basically a female. They'll just have that one X chromosome kind of take over. So when we start to talk about such as like sex and gender, I'm throwing this up here to show that, the world's not always, as easy and like cut and dry as we tend to think it is. There's a lot of complexity to it. If you remember from like just trying to figure out a person's height, right? Our genes can only explain about like 30 some percent of a person's height. A lot of it is just unknown. We don't know how everything works yet. And so this is one of those cases where we don't really understand how sexual development works. All the time, right? If we look back at this. So to keep that in mind. And this is just one, these reported cases are just like this particular one. There's many different types of differences in sexual developments. There are women that can have undescended testicles or men with like underdeveloped ovaries in them. So they have been like raised one way or the other. And usually it's only just one like set of gonads is actually functional. So like you would like a true hermaphrodite having both ovaries and testicles both working and making functional gametes. I don't believe has ever actually been occurred in humans. It's occurred in other creatures, but not humans. Usually it's like one is more developed than the other. So with that being said, words matter. So how we talk about these things matters. So I'm throughout the kind of whole rest of this lecture, I'll be referring to male and female as sex, or they use the term intersex to kind of talk about in between, or that DSD differences in sexual development to refer to kind of the two ex in between the two extremes of like male or female. What I'm not going to talk about in this is like gender. I'm not going to talk about sexuality because those are all kind of basically cultural mechanisms, constructs that we've kind of came up with, right? So, being a male in one culture is different than being a male in another culture, right? So this is all more fluid and maybe not set in stone as we like to think it is. Same with sexuality, your sexual attraction, and as you can see, who you are attracted to, and these all kind of correlate with each other. Your sex, what you identify as, and who you're attracted to or not attracted to, right? There are asexual people out there. So an interesting look at how different other different animals might develop their different sexes. This is an optional video, but feel free to check it out. It's actually really interesting. But we are going to move on and get into basically just like the anatomy here. So the sex organs, so male reproductive and female reproductive system, now that we've kind of cleared out that we're only talking about like sex here. So we're going to go into these. I won't go into gametogenesis, but this is really interesting stuff to get into. So how sperm are actually formed and how eggs are actually formed. So this is one of my favorite words here, oogenesis, and oocyte is the fancy word for an egg. A spermatocyte will eventually develop into a sperm. So we're going to start with male anatomy, however, because it is pretty straightforward. So I'm going to start down here with sperm, right? So sperm are going to be the gametes, the sex cells that will get created in the testes here. And so they have to go through a maturation process. They're not actually like functioning sperm when they're like first created in the testes. They have to travel through this epididymis, and they have to travel through, this is called the ductus deferens or vas deferens. And so they finally don't get really active until they make it down into here and start being added together with some other fluids to form semen or seminal fluid. But this whole process takes, about like 20 some days to like actually grow and mature, but we're doing it like all the time, so men can be making like millions of sperm all the time, and they can get stored. There's these little ampulla up here where they can be stored and kind of waiting and like ready to go. And so to just kind of finish this out, right? Here there's the prostate gland that's going to provide some of the fluid for semen. There is the bulbourethral gland, which is actually going to help lubricate the penis. So this opening right here. This right here is the urethra, also known as the ejaculatory duct. Because in men, if you see, here's the urinary bladder, and then if we had followed through the flow of the semen right here, the reproductive tract and the urinary tract come together very early on, which is different in men than in women, and they combine in the urethra. So they actually will come out the same opening here. So we'll see this will be different in female. So we talked about the prostate, talked about the bulbourethral gland. These are just kind of accessory glands to help build up the semen. And then when the sperm get mixed in with the semen, then they actually kind of get activated, and that's when it's like ready to go. And so the penis, you can see right here, the erectile tissue will engorge with blood. It'll be standing upright for right, and we'll kind of talk about the ejaculatory process a little bit later. And then out the sperm go to try and find an egg. So that is the male anatomy in a nutshell, real quick. We kind of ran through it pretty quickly. The outside area here is obviously this is the scrotum, which would encase the testes. They hang lower. We think probably for temperature control, but not every other like animal species does that. We think part of the reason why they kind of hang in us as opposed to other animals is it might also have to do with sexual selection, and it might be, part of a very early like mating process, and this was like a display trait. So they call it the dangling testicle, because it might not necessarily just only be about temperature, right? A lot of other animals would keep their testicles up inside. And where they actually form, these testes actually formed way up here, back by the kidneys, where the ovaries actually are. And so the ovaries stay where they are in women, but men, as the fetus grows, the testes ended up getting pulled down. And so that's why you can get undescended testicles if they actually don't make it all the way down, or there's a problem or something's happening. So, in case you were curious about that. All right, so if we zoom into the testes right here, so if you actually looked at it's filled with all these seminiferous tubules. And so if you looked into one of these seminiferous tubules, that's where the sperm are actually being made, and then they travel up into the epididymis and will go through the ductus deferens. This ductus deferens, or vas deferens, this is actually what would be cut if someone was going to get a vasectomy or vasectomy. It's this right here. So if I go back, they would cut this to stop the flow of sperm into the ejaculatory tract. So that would be surgical sterilization, but it can be reversed. All right, so here's sperm. They're pretty straightforward. They're kind of funky. The sperm are basically just a helmet, a nucleus, some mitochondria, and a tail. That's all they're good for, right? What they're going to do is really just bring that other half of the chromosomes to the egg, right? And so the egg and sperm can fuse, and the nuclei will fuse, and then the developing embryo, that zygote that gets made, will have the right amount of chromosomes. So again, what they have is just some mitochondria, right? Some energy for the road. This little acrosome is going to help dissolve into the wall of the egg, and you actually need many sperm at once doing this to kind of hopefully get one through the wall of the egg. There's those centrioles, if you remember, those help in cell division. So they have to bring some centrioles with them because they're going to start dividing pretty soon. Here's some other organisms, different types of sperms. You can kind of see they all have the same general outline of having the tail to get them moving through the vaginal tract and up the fallopian tubes, which I'll show you a little bit later. So I won't go into meiosis one and meiosis two again, but if you remember, that's how gametes got made, right? And so this is more specifically how sperm were actually created. So if you took one of these seminiferous tubules, right, and we cut that, and we're kind of looking down it like a hose, from the lining in the wall, this is where the sperm are like developing. So this is like early sperm, and this is like the more mature sperm. And then when they pop out, they're going to travel up the tubules and then make their way through the vas deferens, or the ductus deferens, and hopefully make it to the ejaculatory tract. So here's the rest of the accessory glands for the male reproductive system. I think the only one I left off before was the seminal vesicle. This actually provides most of the fluid for semen, and we'll talk about kind of what goes into that in a second. An average sperm count, about 100 million per milliliter, but it's actually dropping. We're going to talk about that in a second. And since I'm running out of time, this is where I'm going to pick up with part two of the reproductive system. We'll look at what makes up semen.